Hey, it's Damien again, and today we're going to do an introduction to React and what makes it so powerful and why so many companies use it to build their interfaces. In this video, we're going to talk a little bit about what React is, why so many companies use it, and how it kind of works, and what it's built from. This is going to be fairly high level. We're not going to actually look at any React code. We're just going to talk about what it really is. We're going to go into more detail in the coming videos. React is a framework for creating user interfaces. It was developed by Facebook, which they used to build Facebook. Initially just small parts of Facebook, but now the entirety of Facebook is built in React. It's best suited for building pages that have a lot of user interaction, lots of data fetching, very kind of app experiences. But in reality, you can use it to build any website, and lots of people do. Some examples of sites which are built using React are Dropbox, Airbnb, Netflix, Reddit, and BBC, just to name a few. And React is one of the most popular JavaScript frameworks for a very good reason. The core functionality of React can be broken down basically into two main concepts. The first is components and the second is state. Let's talk a little bit about what these two things are. So first, components. This is the idea of breaking down a page into small reusable chunks. And we build a small file or a small function which kind of says how something should be and includes its kind of HTML. So for example, in a list of messages in a chat window, you could have a message component that has all the HTML for how that component should render. It could also have its CSS. And it knows exactly how to deal with its stuff and how to get it into the page. So that's a component. We write the HTML in a language called JSX, which we'll go into more detail. The second concept is state, and this is really one of the core concepts of React. It's the idea of kind of an object or an array or a variable that React keeps track of. And when we change that variable, when we update an array or when we modify an object or we change a string, then React kind of says, oh, something has changed. And it re-renders the HTML that it has previously built. This is why it's called React. It reacts to changes in the data and re-renders the HTML. These two concepts in tandem has made it such a popular framework. Whereas before we would kind of pick parts from a page and kind of have a real knowledge of the entire interface and say like, okay, I've got this new data, I should update that, I should update this, I should do this over here. It breaks things down into small chunks that just automatically update themselves when some data has changed. And this makes it so much better to building larger applications and interfaces. But also, like I said, we can build almost any site in React, and that's because this idea of small components is so nice. You can just reuse your code and not have to copy and paste or remember CSS class names or anything like that. This might sound a little bit abstract, so let's have a little look on a whiteboard of how a React page might be structured and how it looks. So let's have a look at an example use of components. So here I have an example chat list. This should look familiar to you. This could be messages on your phone. It could be Facebook Messenger or WhatsApp or whatever. We have a main kind of window and we have a couple of messages and then we have a form where we can type in a new message and hit send. So if we start by imagining this as React components, we could split this into like three main parts. We have the main thing, which I'll call message list. So that's like the whole component. And then inside of there, we have two very similar components, two message components. Message message. So this is already an example of a reusable component. We could create this component just once and then use it multiple times. Then down here, we have some sort of form component. Okay, so now we have some components. When building this, we have four kind of instances of components on the page, but we only have to create three. When we actually construct our components together like this, and they end up in the DOM on our web page, it's called mounting a component. So we have mounted the message component twice with two different messages. So if we just imagine a little bit how the state for this application could be, because that's the second part of React basically. So think of components as reusable snippets of code, or like Lego blocks. You can just kind of put them in the page and construct something. So let's move on to how the state would look for this application now. We need something to tell our components what their data is. When we send a new message, we need to kind of make it so that our application renders or mounts a third message component. So I'm gonna just give myself some more space here. We have some sort of state in our application. What happens with React is that we will make it so that when we click this send button, we type something in here and we click send, we will pass a new message into our state object. And that's like all as developers that we will actually need to do here, because we will make it so that our message list component reads this state. And it iterates over every message that's in a messages array and mounts a message component for each message. So now that we've added a third message into our list of messages, React will say behind the scenes, it'll say, okay, I've got new information here. I've got new state. I should mount a third message component and automatically update the DOM for us. Just again, to give an analogy back to the vanilla HTML that we've been writing, if we were doing this in normal HTML and JavaScript, to get this action to work, we would need to listen to the submit event in a very similar way. We'd need to take the message, and then we would need to think, what do I need to do with this information? And we would need to say like, okay, well, I need to inject some more HTML into the DOM here. And that's what React really does, is gets rid of that next step for us. We just think, okay, I've got a new message, I'll put it into this state. And then everything that's listening to that state will just automatically update. So if we just build one more function into our little app here, let's say we had a little notification bubble up here, which had the number of unread messages. If we were doing this with normal JavaScript again, we would need to say, okay, I've got a new message, so I need to put it in there. Oh, and also I need to update this number up here. But with React, we don't need to, because this component will also just listen to our state. So it'll say, oh wait, there's a new message here, I should update myself. So hopefully this clarifies a little bit about how React works. Obviously, we're going to go into a lot more detail about how to actually make this happen. But I'd like to just kind of summarize what's going on here. So I'm just going to clear off the whiteboard. Boom, clean whiteboard. Okay, so if we just summarize what happened in our message list there. We had a chunk of HTML, like the result of our components. We have our app here with all our components, messages and a form at the bottom, and then that React rendered that to HTML. And then we updated our state when this button was clicked. And so then React said, okay, there's a new version of our HTML here now, which has three messages. We triggered an update to our state, React redrew like the result of what's about to come to the page, and then it spits out a new chunk of HTML and updates the page for us. This is why we don't need to do document.getElementById in React, for example. it will figure out what needs to be updated in the page for us, and we'll just generate new HTML and update the page. This flow is basically what React is doing. It's re-rendering its interface based on changes to state. So these state updates can be triggered in a number of different ways. It could be user interaction, such as this, where we click a button and we feed the state some new information. It could be the result of API calls, so we call an external server, get some data back, put it in our state, and then React re-renders the page. Or it could be more kind of behind the scenes things, such as timers or just events in the browser. So this is where we're going to be going with React. We build these interfaces that react to changes in state. Let's go into a little bit of detail about how we're going to break this up and how we're going to approach learning this. Of course, there's a lot more to React than just components and state, but they are the main functionality of React. So our plan is to go through it like this. We're going to start with just talking about how to create these React components. And then we're going to talk about how to break down interfaces and how to think in React, how to create these different components. Then we're going to talk a lot more about state, like what it is in a bit more detail and how to update it. Then we're going to talk about using APIs to update your React state, how to create these kind of really rich applications. We're then going to go into using some of the most popular libraries that you use to give React extra functionality. And then we're also going to go into how to structure your state and use state in a very large application, how to have state that will work across a big application. So in this video, we've talked about what React is and the methodology behind how React works to react to changes in state and update our DOM for us. In the coming videos, we're going to talk a lot more about how to create our first components and how to start getting these kind of rich components into the page. You should install the React Developer Tools in Chrome. We'll provide a link in this week's material. And once you have that in Chrome, it gives you a little icon in your toolbar. It lights up when a page is using React. So for example, after you install the extension, if you then go to Facebook, for example, you'll see that Facebook is using React because the icon will become colorful. We'll show in the future as well how to use this extension to help us debug our pages and how to see the components that are in a React app. Try to pay attention to this icon in Chrome when you're just browsing the internet, when you're going around your normal day. You'll be surprised how many sites use React and how often you'll see that little icon light up. And when you do find a new one, share it with your teammates. It's really fun to see new sites that are using React. There's thousands of them out there. So that's all from me today. I look forward to seeing you all next time, where we can dig deeper into React. We can react to it. What's going on here? So I'm just going to clear off the whiteboard. I think they should be forced to watch every part.